Hello and welcome to Gilder Fluke and Company's Brown Bag Training Seminar. My name is Richard, and this week we will be talking about the bright sign players along with the Gilder script and a couple of the adapters for the bright sign players. So first, let's start out with where you can find the equipment that you may be looking for your particular application. So we go to our website and immediately just go up to the search window, type in v-dash and enter. And it's going to give you all of our video devices. Starting out at the top is the serial adapter 2. That's actually for the Mini Brick 4. So we'll start with the v-HD starter kit, which primarily consists of a Gilder script, which is included with a 8 GB memory card, class 10. It also has a v-Hd-to-1/4 J6 optically isolated adapter, GPIO adapter board, along with a ribbon cable and a 10 position transition connector board, basically ribbon cable to screw terminal board for you. And also includes a CD-ROM. So the v-HD starter kit is recommended if you need any of these items. You can get them all in a package at a slightly discounted price. Okay, so let's go to the next device. Well, then we have just the Gilder script by itself, which is simply a memory card with the script on it. Now, the Gilder script, what that does is that allows you to set up your memory card using folders. These folders have to have specific names. The first one would be background loop. If you have any video files that need to be looped in the background. And then you have your playlist folders. So they should be labeled playlist 001 all the way up through playlist 255. Okay, and what that allows you to do is to be able to access those playlists using a contact closure or using the GPIO port, which we have two adapters that can be plugged in there. We have the v-Hd-to-1/4 J6 adapter. There should be a page just for that one. Where are the adapters? Here it is. Okay. So this one can be used with any of our digital output devices, whether that is a Mini Brick 8, even a Mini Brick 4, Multi Brick 32, Z Brick, even our SD50/8 or SD50/40. Is compatible with this device. So basically, you're going to plug your digital outputs into the adapter ribbon cable connector end. And you have 8 control lines that you can use. So you can use those 8 control lines to access up to 8 playlist folders. And that's what we call direct selection. So with direct selection, you're going to be limited to 8 or less playlist folders, and each of the 8 optically isolated inputs will be assigned to one of the 8 folders. Now, if you have 9 or more video files and you want to access them individually, once you go over the threshold of 8 playlist folders, starting with 9, then we switch over from direct selection to what we call binary selection. And that'll give you the ability to select up to 255 different playlist folders. Now, in each playlist folder, you can have one or more videos. You cannot have an empty playlist folder. That's not going to work at all, and you'll experience a bit of trouble with that. So make sure that you always have at least a single video or audio file in your playlist folders, and you won't run into any trouble. Now, let's see. Here's the pinout for the v-Hd-to-1/4 J6. It basically is our standard 1/4 J6 digital port, and the pinout is the same on all of our digital output devices. Okay, so this is the connection here, and this is how you would wire up the switches on this side here. Okay, let's go back to our next adapter. Should be right behind this one. There it is there. That is our v-HD-to-DMX. So this basically turns any of our bright sign players into a DMX controlled video player. So this little adapter actually allows you to connect a DMX signal to it to select your videos to be played. So on this little adapter, you have a DMX in and a DMX through. So it doesn't actually retransmit. It just simply passes through the DMX on the input so that you can daisy chain and go to other devices if needed. We have three address switches. The one on the far left would be your 100. The one in the middle is your 10s. And the one on the right is your 1's position. So if you wanted 255, you wanted to set this one to address 255, you would set the one on the left to 2, the one in the middle to 5, and the one on the right to 5. And that will give you address 255. Now we also have a 2-position dip switch selector. this selector will allow you to, I believe, bit number 1. If it's off, it will allow you to use 1-based addressing. If it's on, it'll allow you to use 0-based addressing. Okay, so in the on position, you have addresses 0 through 511 that are available. And if it's off, you have addresses 1 through 512 available for addressing. Dip switch number 2 gives you the ability to use a single DMX address or 8 consecutive DMX addresses for selecting your video files. Now, all of that is going to be explained in the, there should be a manual for it, which is a PDF file. Let me just open that up really quickly. Okay. Make that a little larger there. And here's also the pinout for the wiring. Basically, it takes a Ethernet cable or 8-wire connection. Pins 1 and 2 would be your DMX plus and minus. Pins 7 and 8 would be your ground. Okay, and then pins 3 through 5 are not used. All right. So yeah, going back to dip switch number 2, if you have it in the on position, it will allow you to use 8 consecutive DMX 512 addresses for triggering. But the value on each of those addresses must go above 50% in order to make that a output or that input active. Okay. So that is the basics. We also have, which we should talk about, is, let's minimize that, is the GilderScript itself. Oh, actually, that was on the same, just up a little further. Okay, so for the GilderScript, here we are here. This is how you should set up your folders. Background loop, playlist 001, playlist 002, playlist 003, so on and so forth. Now, there is an error with this dollar sign here. That should not be there. That dollar sign does not have any effect. But if you read through this three-page manual, you'll notice that you can make any playlist randomly accessible by adding an ampersand to the end of the file name, okay? So that's what that is there. So that's gonna turn that particular folder, and that's all the video, audio and video files in that folder will be accessed in a random order, okay? So that's all you need to do in order to make that folder a random playback, okay? Is add the ampersand at the end of the folder name. Then there's one more that will allow you to set that folder to non-steppable playback, and that is here. If you add an exclamation point to the file name, as it is done here with playlist 3, that will make all audio and video files in that folder non-steppable. So that means that when it's initially started, it's going to play to the end before the player will allow you to send a new file start. Okay, and then I believe playlist 5 was supposed to be an ampersand and an exclamation point to make it non-steppable and random. It just looks like there's a typo here, so just ignore the little dollar sign. There's no active function that the dollar sign is going to give you at all. So basically just those two changes to the file name, or I'm sorry, to the folder name will make all the files in that folder either non-steppable or random. Now you can also add those same, not with the random function, but with the non-steppable playback, you can also add that function to any individual file as well. Okay, and that's what this says down here. By simply adding the exclamation point to the end of the file name, as it is shown here on file number 3, there's an exclamation point to make that one file unsteppable. All the others are steppable. And as you can see here, you have several different file types that are usable using the bright sign GilderScript, MP4, VOB, MPG, MOV, and TS, okay? So that pretty much handles all of the hardware with the exception of the bright sign players. Now this is an older PDF file, which all of the video players that are listed here have been discontinued. So we have updated video players. So let me go over to those really quickly. Okay, so on our website, you may notice that each bright sign player may appear twice, as the VLS422 does. However, it has a DMX extension behind it. Now, that simply adds these two devices that you see here, the memory card with the GilderScript, as well as the v-Hd-to-DMX adapter. So you can add one or both of these to any one of our video players that has a GPIO port, okay? That's the main requirement in order to use the adapter, is the video players must have a GPIO port in order to use it. So let's really quickly, let's take a look at some of the current players that we have. If you simply just click on the picture, it'll take you to that particular product. And if you scroll down, well, at the top, you'll notice that it tells you what contents are included in the package. So if there's any question, you can just check here, or you can just give us a call at our office number. This one doesn't have it. Let me go back. There we go. Okay, so you should be able to find this small little table here that will basically break down the different video players that we do have. And all of these should be on our website. We have the basic players, which are the VHD and the VLS, which offer 1080p, a high definition resolution. And then we have the basic features of each of the products, okay? And then we also have the XD, which is the, we would say, medium resolution with all of the different features. And then we have the highest resolution players, which are our 4K ultra high def players, okay? So all of these are available. At any point, just give us a call. Let us know which one you want. Let us know if you need the VHD starter kit, or if you want to make that package a DMX package. And then we will include the appropriate adapter. And that these are the two adapters that are available. VHD to 1/4 J6 and VHD to DMX. All righty. So next thing I'm going to do now is to basically just set up a video, a memory card with videos on it. So basically the videos that I'm going to be using, we use all the time using our motion-based platform. So I'll go ahead and I'll start with that, setting up videos. Okay, so we'll, we have a 8 megabyte SDHC memory card. Okay, and we're going to go ahead and drop it into the computer and we'll set it up. I already have a memory card set up currently running on the player, but I'm not gonna show it just yet. First, let's talk about how to set up the memory card. So I insert it into my card reader writer on my laptop here. Okay. Now, especially if you're using the 4K video players, you must have a class 10 or better memory card, okay? You're not gonna get very good playback at all if you don't have a class 10 memory card. So make sure that you, if you do order your own memory card or get it from a outside vendor, that you do get at least a class 10 if you're gonna be using the 4K ultra high def players. Alrighty, so I have my memory card inserted. First thing I'm going to do is format it using FAT32. And that looks like the default. I'll give it a label, click on start, format it, and it's done. Great. Okay. Okay, so these are my video files that I need to move on over to my drive, control A. So I'll start out with those. Now, if you wanted to just verify that your Brightsign player is working, you can simply just drag and drop one or more video files onto a freshly formatted memory card without the GilderScript. Insert it into your video player and power it up. What will happen is the Brightsign player should loop all of the video files on the memory card successfully. Now that's normal, okay? What we do is we add the GilderScript that allows you to set up your memory card with independently accessible folders. Okay, so if you're having any trouble and you're not quite sure exactly what's going on, just try putting a freshly formatted memory card with one or more video files onto the memory card by itself and insert into the Brightsign player, power it up. If the Brightsign player is gonna play those, it should play them on power up right away. So that's one way of testing it out if you're having any trouble at all. At that point, then you can go ahead and drop your GPIO on over to the memory card, and that file is called autorun.brs, bright sign script. And then I also include the three-page manual, which is a small PDF file for any GPIO scripts that go out from our office. Okay, so we have those over there. Let me go ahead and find some video files to put over there. Okay. So here are all of my video files. I'll just drag and drop them all over at once. Okay, so let's give that a few moments. Okay, yeah, so it is copying, it's taking its time. Depending on the size of your video files, it may take, and the quantity of video files, it may take a little bit longer, it may take a little bit less time. But we're slowly but surely working our way through. So I actually have several files that will go into our background loop folder, and it looks like it's copying those first. 1, 2, 3, 4. I think there is a fifth one. I'm not quite sure. Nonetheless, we'll definitely see them all when I create the folders, and then I'll drop the videos into the folders. So we are about 60% complete.
Richard, are there, question? There any limit to the number of folders that you can have?
Yeah, the limit of folders is 255. And that's primarily because of the number of triggerable inputs is 8. So yeah, since there's only 8 control lines coming in, that's going to limit the number of folders to 255.
Within each folder, would you only be limited then to the size of your flash card?
Yeah, there's no limit to the number of video files that can be played back. However, there is a limit on the number of folders that can be independently accessed. So depending on the size of your memory card, you can obviously put as much audio, video on there that you can actually get on there. So it looks like we're done. Okay, yeah, and there's my other background folder. So let me go ahead and create a few folders. Background loop. And then I will drop all of my background files in there. Okay. Playlist 001 will get the first file. And you'll notice I rearranged my list after copying so that they would appear in alphabetical order. just so I have a better idea as to what file is in what folder. But you can obviously put whatever file you want in whatever folder. Let's see. And what I'm doing here is just copying what I'm using as a file name so that I don't have to type it every single time. To enter. All right, let's drop in the next one. Next one. Okay, so I've only created four playlists. Or eight playlists because I have eight folders. Okay, so that should do it. Just make sure I got one in each folder. There's Ghost, Roller Coaster. Come on. Space Race, Star Wars, Test Track. Beautiful. Okay. What I'm going to do now, didn't want to go in there. Let's rename. Put the ampersand. Oh, that's the dollar sign. There we go. Okay. So that one should make that folder random. Let's go to playlist 4. This one is Ghost. Let's make that one non-steppable. With the exclamation point, okay?
The exclamation point has to be before the extension?
Yes. Exclamation point should be at the end of the file name, but before the file extension, yes. Okay. That should do it. Okay. So let me eject the disk. Eject. Currently in use. Really? Eject. There we go. Safe to remove hardware. Thank you. There we go. It's complete. So let's go ahead and insert it into the BrightSign player. Now you'll notice with the BrightSign, I have the v-Hd-to-DMX. I'll set that up in a second. But right now I have a v-Hd-to-1/4 J6 connected to a mini brick 8. And as you can see, a short ribbon cable there is all that is needed. The mini brick 8 is already powered up, but the bright sign is not. So let me go ahead and insert the memory card. Then I'll power up the LS422. And we should see video playing here in a second. Give it a sec. There we go. Okay. All right. So that's one of the five background videos. This one, is that red or is that pink? What do you think? Is that pink? Let's call that pink. Okay. Because there are several of them. As a matter of fact. Okay. So the mini brick 8 basically is just set up to trigger one of the 8 outputs. So there's basically 8 really short shows. And each of the shows has a single output. Okay, so let me see. I have KP300. Green, purple, red. I'm not sure what the S is for. Okay. Well, let's go ahead and trigger a show. So I'll just hit the green input on the mini brick 8. And that's going to hope. Well, I'm not sure which output. So let me power it down and back up. Okay. Okay. So bit 0 should come on here. And the associated bit 0 on the quarter J6. Should light up, which should start playing video in playlist number 1, which is going to be the airplane flying. So that one is kind of cool. So I'll go ahead and hit it now. There we go. We got a red LED. And we should have a video playing. Oh. All right, let's try video number 2. Roller coaster or coaster. And video number 3. That's the danger video. This is the ghost video. Now this one should be non-steppable. So if I hit the input button, it shouldn't do anything. Yeah, it's not responding. Okay. Which one was that for? So we actually need to let this one play all the way to the end. Yeah, this is the one that I set for a non-steppable playback.
And the lag between the clips, is that because you're triggering it with the mini brick, or is there a way to tighten up that lag?
More than likely, the video itself has a dead space in the front of it. Nonetheless, though, when you're syncing to any audio or video, you should give yourself anywhere from half a second to a full second before starting any animation, just to make sure that you're going to sync up. So now we're playing a different background loop where we had started out with, I believe it was pink, and now we have a blue one. Okay, so I'll go ahead and hit the go button on the mini brick 8. Now I actually cycled through all of the shows on the mini brick, but the bright sign player was basically told to ignore any early starts. So I went on and cycled back to where I left off. So it should play the video in playlist number 5 with the next press. And there we go. That's actually bit number 4, which is the 5th one since we started at 0. Okay. Which one is this? This one is the roller coaster. The next one should be space race. Okay, a little vertigo there. And the next one is Star Wars. And then the last one is Test Track. All right. So that is the v-Hd-to-1 quarter J6. And once again, as you can see, it's connected using a ribbon cable, which is receiving its signal from a digital output controller, one of many that we manufacture here at Gilder Fluke & Company. So you can actually use this with a Mini Brick 4, a Mini Brick 8, as we have here. A multi-brick 32. You can also use a Z-brick. You can also use an SD 58 or an SD 5040. So those are our all of our digital output devices that can be used with the v-Hd-to-1/4 J6. So if you're not using any of our digital output devices, you can still utilize the v-Hd-to-1/4 J6. You simply would need to provide the correct type of signal, which is a syncing powered switch closure. So all of our digital output devices are open collector output devices. So they share a common positive. So in the off state, the output is actually high, and when it goes active, the output goes low to activate the device that you're controlling, which would be the v-Hd-to-1/4 J6. So let's switch on over from the quarter J6 adapter to the v-Hd-to-DMX. Okay, so right now, this guy is addressed at 000 with both dip switches in the off position. Focus, there we go. All right, so let's go ahead and connect that guy. Now I have a special cable that I made because we actually have an Ethernet connection on this side, and the Mini Brick 8 has a special connector that I added to it, okay? So I'll connect the cable. Now I've already set up the Mini Brick 8 to transmit DMX 512. And as you can see, it has a red and yellow LEDs are blinking really, really quickly. That's the indication that it is actually transmitting DMX 512, or it should be transmitting DMX 512. I know it's kind of hard to see that power connector's in the way there. I don't know if you can see that or not. Nonetheless, let's go ahead and set this guy up. So I'll plug in the DMX cable that I made. And then, okay, so it looks like we're on orange now. Huh? That's cool. We'll plug that in. And you notice you get a flashing green LED to let you know that you're receiving a valid DMX signal. Well, I'm seeing a bunch of glare here, but I'm hoping that you can see this just fine. Okay, so the flashing green LED is over here. Let you know that you're receiving a good DMX 512 signal. Okay, and flashing about once per second. Now, because there is no DMX signal. Can you see it on your feet?
No,
the LED?
Much
wow. Oh, well, too much glare. Moving right along. And it doesn't matter which port you plug into. Uh-oh. It accidentally triggered a video. And it would show, it would trigger the one that that shouldn't have happened. yeah, so just plugging in the DMX, apparently it saw a signal there and it played video number 4. So we have to wait until it gets all the way to the end. Okay, so let's see. I think we had started over. Okay, so there's the green one. All righty, so we'll go ahead and we will trigger the first one. That's the airplane flying. Here's video number 2. That's video number 3. Now I'm going to disconnect because I want to skip over 4. And play video number 5. Number 6. And number 7. And number 8. There we go. Okay. So that that's the demo for the v-Hd to DMX. We've already went over the v-Hd to 1/4 J6. We went over setting up your memory card using the GPIO. We went over setting up the folders on the memory card using the GPIO, as well as a couple of the options. Which deal with random playback as well as a non-steppable playback. We went over the different video players available. We went over the connections as well. Yeah, so if there are any questions, I hope we can get those in really quickly before we end. Anything?
No.
No questions? How about you?
Dennis?
Uh-uh.
Come on, you gotta have one question. Why is the bright sign purple in color? I have no idea.
Royalty.
Yeah, purple is royalty.
What kind of show I was supposed to put on the mini break in order to trigger the videos?
Okay, so the question is, what type of show should we put on the mini break to trigger the videos? Well, the mini break is actually, it's a self-contained show controller. Is that a question? Okay, so I'll answer that question in a second. But to answer your question, the type of show, it all depends on what effect you're looking for. The MiniBrick 8 has 8 digital outputs, so you may have maybe a couple of the outputs set up to either maybe power up a couple of relays. You may even have a a couple of servos plugged in. So you may not use all of the digital outputs for starting your videos at all. For instance, since the MiniBrick 8 will give you 64 channels of DMX 512, you can very easily use the first 8 digital outputs for controlling different aspects of your show, whether they're relays or LEDs or motors or whatever it may be, solenoid valves. You can even connect 2 servo motors to the MiniBrick 8, and then you can have your video cues or video starts on a higher DMX address. Whereas the MiniBrick 8 has hardwired to the first, second, and third addresses in that order, or the digitals are going to always be hardwired to the very first output address. And then the 2 servos will take the next 2 consecutive addresses. So you have the digitals are going to basically be on address 0. Your 2 servos, if you're using those, would be on address 1 and 2. And then you can assign your VHD to DMX to DMX address 3. You just simply just set the appropriate address that you want it to listen to for its cues. So it all depends on the different aspects that you're trying to incorporate into your show. So you primarily would use our programming software, PC Max, for creating the output data or the show data for your MiniBrick 8. And then either reserve a single 8-bit channel for your video cues using obviously digital channels, or you can use 8 consecutive DMX channels. And in that case, you can either use analog or digital. But if you're going to use 8 consecutive addresses, you need to make sure that the value on that particular address reaches above the threshold of 50% to go active. So yeah, once again, it all depends on what different aspects you have in that particular show. If you're just simply using it as a video player to start your videos to play, you don't actually necessarily need a MiniBrick 8 to communicate with the VHD to DMX. You can actually use a lighting console that will spit out a DMX 512. And you just need to make sure that the wiring is correct between the DMX source and your VHD to 1/4 J6, and you'll be able to start your different videos. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Any more questions?
Gregory Yanks wants to know what player are you using today?
Oh, okay. Hi, Gregory. Today we're using an LS422. Let me see. Yeah, it doesn't say 422 on it. It just simply says LS. But yeah, this is the basic version of our Bright Sign player, the LS422. This one replaces the v-HD-120, I believe. So yeah, this is one of the basic players. It does have, let me see, it does have Ethernet, yeah. HDMI output. It also has SPDI, and it also has a USB connection as well. And it looks like it also has a stereo audio output port also, which is right here. Yeah, so this is our basic player. And then we have several different versions of players as well, which you can find on our website. There are several of them, the LS422, the HD222, the HD1022. Then we have the XD series, which starts out with the XD232, the XD1032, the XD1132. And then we have the 4K players, which start out with the 4K 242, the 4K 1042, and the 4K 1142, all with different available features. Okay, and it looks like all of these guys have the GPIO port. That's great. Cool.
He's in encountering a 7-second lag time from the pressing of the button till the video plays, but he's not saying which player he's using, although he does say that the XD players are much faster in responding. So is there right. a way to that he could tighten up that 7-second delay?
Well, I'll answer that question like this. As you all probably already know, GilderFluke and Company does not actually manufacture these video players. So there's only so much that we can do when it comes to tightening that up. The first thing, obviously, would be to make sure that that you have a high-speed memory card. Class 10 would obviously be a very good choice. If you have anything lower than that, if you're not actually using the 4K player, you don't actually require a Class 10 memory card, but it certainly does help. The brand of the memory card has a lot to do with the access times along with the class of the memory card. So you obviously want something that's going to have a very, very low access time, which is the reason for the Class 10 memory card. So if you haven't switched to a Class 10 memory card, that would certainly be recommended. Another thing is obviously to make sure that there's not a lot of blank or black screen at the beginning of your video. Now, when it comes to sending a signal to the bright sign player, you literally can shorten the access time by stepping up your class or the speed access speed of your memory card. That's about the only suggestion that I have. I'm not a 100% expert on products that we do not manufacture, so. I have very little knowledge on the bright sign players, but if you give us a call at the office, I'm sure we can help you figure out what needs to be done to increase your videos being played back from receiving a start signal. Sorry, I don't have a better answer for you, but like I said, we don't manufacture the bright sign players, so my knowledge will obviously be limited when it comes to those guys. Are there any other questions at this point? No. Okay. All righty. So I think that's going to do it for today's brown bag session. I appreciate everybody showing up. I appreciate all the questions. If you have additional questions, you can either give us a call here at GilderFluke and Company here in Burbank, California, or you can shoot us an email at info@gilderfluke.com, and we'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have, or even give you a quick walkthrough or whatever it is that you need. Okay. I think that should do it. So thanks a lot for attending GilderFluke and Company's Brown Bag Training Seminar on the Bright Sign Video Players and GilderScript. Thank you, and see you in a couple of weeks.